Patna, and he's also a member ARC for East Zone. I'm Dr. Krishna Prasad Kudlu, the convener for poster podium presentation. This is the first time in the history of All India Ophthalmic Society we are doing the poster podium presentation. I was in touch with a couple of our judges due to some cancellation of some flights. So I request Dr. Chinnappa and Dr. Vikram to judge this session. And please proceed. And the rules and regulations.
Good morning, everybody. We welcome you all to the first session of the poster podium presentation of AAOC 2019. Welcome you all here. Without wasting much time, let's cut straight to the chase and start the session. The first paper would be to compare the visual outcomes of simultaneous with delayed bilateral cataract surgery in children. Presenting author being Dr. Manisha. Is Dr. Manisha here? No? Okay. Coming to the second paper, FP299, should macular OCT be included as a screening tool prior to routine cataract surgeries? Dr. Himali Kapania? Is not here? Strange. Number three would be to compare the efficacy of topical steroids versus NSAIDs following cataract surgery. Dr. Ramlal Sharma.
Hello. So should we start?
Yeah, please
start. Good morning, everyone here and the chairperson. I am presenting the study on comparison of efficacy of topical steroid versus NSAID following cataract surgery. The study was detected in Department of Ophthalmology, IG Medical College, Shimla. We had taken 120 patients, which were divided into two groups, 60 of each. First was moxifloxacin plus bromifenac in one of the group as a post-operative medication. And another group, it was moxi plus prednisolone in the second group as a single medication post-operative treatment in uncomplicated phacoemulsification. The schedule of treatment was 6 times daily for initial 2 weeks, followed by another 2 weeks, 4 times daily, and then 2 times daily for another 2 weeks. That was the 6-month schedule in these cases. As we know, steroids have their own problem, let it be topical, multiple effects, delayed healing, intraocular pressure, rising microbial infection, and multiple things are there. That was idea whether we can do without steroid in uncomplicated cases or not. So we had taken 4 criteria, that is the congestion, striated keratopathy, AC cells, AC flare, as an inflammatory parameter that will tell that how much these two factors work. They were scored based on nil, mild, moderate, and severe, 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 0 as minimum and 3 as the maximum. So these were the criteria taken. Then we ultimately compared them on the various graphs, and we found that conjunctival congestion and striated keratopathy, except for initial 2 weeks where the steroid group responded slightly better, the results at the end of 6 weeks were equal in both the cases. Similar was the situation of anterior chamber flare and cell, and that also almost resolved within 6 weeks in both the groups equally at 6 weeks, while in first week there was slight earlier resolution in the steroid group cases. There were studies which showed that prednisolone acetate plus antibiotic combination works well in good number of cases, and it has an important role in inflammation resolution. There were also a study where the bromifenac or the topical NSAID were compared in these cases. Out of these 120 patients, we dropped only one case due to excessive inflammation, as he required even oral steroid to control the inflammation. As you know, some of these patient, they behave unusually for the inflammation part. But in our study, we concluded that bromifenac is as effective as prednisolone in reducing inflammation after cataract surgery in uncomplicated phacoemulsification. That's actually the crux of our study. It can replace prednisolone in uneventful surgery. Steroids should be replaced by NSAID in uncomplicated cases. Thank you very much.
So was your study a retrospective study or a prospective study?
It was a prospective study.
Any reason that you chose 60 patients as the number that to be included in the
no,
study?
No, it was just taken since it was a one-year thesis study actually. That's the reason that we calculated the sample from our statistician, and he told that 60 sufficient sample will be sufficient for this.
So then, so was it on pro renata that you considered the phacoemulsification to be uncomplicated on table? Or the next post of day you assessed?
Next post of day. If somebody developed complication, then we did not include this study.
So you mean to say if there was a very high incidence of anterosegment inflammation, you would put them on
obviously.
Steroids? And if there was no inflammation?
No, only during surgery, if it was an uncomplicated surgery, that was the criteria, not postoperatively.
Okay. Now, what doctors are trying to ask is, when was the randomization done? Would you do it after seeing the patient on post-op day one, or on table you would decide that this patient goes into...
On table, once the surgery is uneventful.
So that time you decide.
Yeah.
Okay, was there any exclusion criteria when it came to diabetes or any other systemic disease?
Yes, all those criteria were cut due to the paucity of time. I did not mention that.
Okay. Thank you, doctor. Thank you. Could we have the next presentation on, please? We have with us Dr. Amrita Verma. She'll be speaking about the comparison of macular thickness changes in uneventful phacoemulsification and SICS using SDOCT. Dr. Verma.
Good morning, respected judges, seniors, and my dear colleagues. We did a comparison of macular thickness changes in uneventful phacoemulsification and SICS using spectral domain OCT. We know that both phaco and manual SICS are established methods of cataract extraction, with surgical trauma leading to release of prostaglandins and blood retinal barrier disruption leading to macular changes and cystoid edema. We did a study to evaluate and compare the change in macular thickness after uncomplicated phaco and SICS. It was done from March 2017 to March 2018. It was a quasi-experimental study with clearance from the ethical committee. We included all patients above 40 years of age undergoing cataract surgery with cataract grading from 2 to 4, and uneventful cataract surgery was there. We excluded any patient that showed any macular pathology, other retinopathies, glaucoma, previous surgeries, or any topical or systemic medication known to interfere with retinal thickness. All consecutive patients undergoing surgery were taken, and 60 patients were divided in two groups by convenient sampling. Group A had phacoemulsification patients, and Group B had those with SICS. We measured the central foveal thickness and mean retinal thickness in these patients preoperatively, postoperatively, day one, week one, 4 weeks, and 6 weeks. Coming to the results, the two groups were comparable in their nuclear grading, the sexual ratio, and the age. When we saw the central foveal thickness changes, we found that the first post-operative day, the thickness slightly seemed reduced when measured by the OCT, and by 6 weeks, it used to come back to normal. It was seen as same for both the groups. Seeing the average retinal thickness at 3 millimeters, and 6 millimeters diameters also showed the same kind of finding. So the study demonstrated a decrease in retinal thickness in all quadrants on the first post-operative day. This may be attributed to the segmentation errors in SDOCT while evaluating retinal thickness in cataract size. This has earlier been reported by Kim et al. Both groups showed an increase in thickness at 1 and 4 weeks, and it seemed to return back to normal at 6 weeks. The difference in the degree of increase in both groups was statistically insignificant, and we did not have any cases of cystoid macular edema in either groups. Concluding, there is no statistically significant difference in change of macular thickness when we compare the two surgeries. The shortcomings for the study was that it was a small sample size, and there was we could have measured a relative change of visual acuity in both the cases. Thank you.
Yeah. Doctor, you said that the drop in the first post-operative day macular thickness was because it could have been because of segmentation errors because of dense cataracts. Yes. But then you said that at 6 weeks it again came back to normal. So that means it was not segmentation errors.
Sir, the segmentation errors have been noted, like when there are cataracts, so preoperatively when we measured.
Yes.
So what we saw, the thickness was actually false high.
Probably. Okay, but then it came back to the same thickness at 6 weeks. So
Yes, maybe it was slightly higher than at
so
six
that
weeks.
Means like
it
you know
has not come back to the baseline.
So it you mean to say that the retinal the macular thickness increased with time post-operatively?
Yes, sir.
It increased with time.
It did. And then by 6 weeks, it started coming down again. Because like if we had preoperatively around 316 microns or something, then it went up. First POD, we saw it was lesser. First week, it went to like 333, 343. Then it started coming down again by 4 weeks, and by six it had come down again, though not back to the baseline level.
Okay. What was the equipment that you used to measure the?
So we used Heidelberg.
Heidelberg. Okay. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
To call upon Dr. Satyajit Sinha, he'll be speaking about the analysis of offering high-end investigations to predict visual outcomes in routine cataract surgeries.
Respected judges, August gathering. Today I'll be talking on the analysis of offering high-end investigations that we give to our patients. So sometimes we face a situation where our colleagues feel that the test that was offered was not necessary, but more often than not, the patient immediately gets a setback when you say you have to get a OCT or a specular microscopy done before a cataract surgery. As it is, it's a burden on him or her for the cataract surgery, and then when you say that you have to get a OCT done, he really doesn't understand what is macula, what is OCT, and he sees the financial burden associated with it. And we wanted to do an analysis of the same. And cataract patients have expectations for surgical outcomes, high expectations, and that is one of the main reasons which is the biggest problem. Various factors predict the post-operative visual outcome in cataract patients. Careful examination of the cornea and macula is mandated before cataract surgery. In our busy OPD, we go ahead and see grade 2, grade 3 cataracts and just go ahead and write left SICS or left phaco or whatever we have to write. But we have to take care of the cornea and the macula so that the patient is not disappointed at the end of the day. Biomicroscopical detection of subtle macular abnormalities through a cataract is challenging. It's sometimes it becomes difficult to see the macula. Failure to identify them may result in onerous treatment decisions, unrealistically high expectations of post-operative visual improvement. OCT has been proved to improve the accuracy of the post-operative preoperative diagnostic process. OCT also helps avoid misdiagnosis and post-operative macular surprises. Now, specular microscopy is another one thing which the patient does not understand at all. And you have to really motivate the patient to get this test done, which at many centers costs 1,000 to 1,500 to 2,000, which is a lot of money for the patient. Now, other than what the patient is feeling or what difficulty he has, at the end of the day, if the patient doesn't get a good vision, you may have to face medico-legal cases because it will go for a second opinion, and then your colleague may ask whether an OCT was done before. Later, if you tell the patient there was a macular hole, the patient is not satisfied and he thinks something went wrong in the surgery. Now, it's a two-way thing. It becomes a big dilemma for the surgeon. You have to offer this OCT test and specular microscope. It costs money. The patient is worried. You are also worried as a doctor that the patient may run away and go to the next patient. So it's very important to properly counsel the patient. Our aim was to analyze high-end investigations in predicting visual outcomes. We did for 324 patients undergoing cataract surgery between October 2017 and March 2018. Single surgeon, single center with grade 2 and grade 3 cataract. Exclusion criteria was mature cataract and significant macular pathology, which was already excluded from before. Normal routine patients were taken. Routine cataract investigations were done. High-end investigations were advised. And counselor was assigned to make the patient understand the importance of these tests. The results showed that 208 patients were very apprehensive, 78 patients got it done reluctantly, and 38 got the investigations readily. So out of 324, only 38 got it done readily. Of the 116 patients who had grade 2 and grade 3 and got preoperative high-end tests done readily, of the 116 who had got it done, 8 had macular pathologies. 5 had decreased endothelial cell count, which would have hurt the endothelium during the phaco surgery. Patients are elected to get high-end investigations done. Proper counseling is needed to convince them of the importance of the investigation and prevent the treating doctor from medico-legal hassles. And reduced charges and counseling by operative surgeon convinces the patient more to get the investigation done. There is enough evidence to prove the importance of OCT of macula and specular microscopy before cataract surgery. OCT macula and specular microscopy should be mandatory preoperatively. The investigation will help the surgeon prognosticate visual outcomes post-cataract surgery. They will also help the patient expect realistic visual outcomes post-operatively. Thank you.
Thank you, doctor. So you said only 38 of them actually readily got it done.
Yes.
But the others got it done as well.
78 or 76 of them were very reluctantly got it done after much counseling.
Okay, were there patients who refused to get this get the investigations done and yet went on to go
and
do the surgery?
Went on to get the surgery done. Yes,
they were.
All the patients were there for.
Okay.
Did undergo cataract surgery.
Okay. Thank you so much. Next,
Santosh Kashyap.
Yes.
Good morning, respected teachers. Here I am presenting my work on preliminary results of new technique of sutureless, glueless, scleral fixated IUL. Among various modalities of IUL implantation in aphakia, SFR implantation is one of the promising ones, having more advantage than other options. Gabarettol in 2007 and Amaragrawal et al. In 2008 introduced new technique of sutureless SFR implantation. But there is dependency on special instruments like microexist forceps and fibrin glue. So here we developed a much simpler technique for sutureless, glueless, intrascleral fixation of three-piece posterior chamber IUL using 26 Coase needle. Our aims and objective here to assess the visual outcome, intraoperative and postoperative complications, and the cost effectiveness of our technique. It was a prospective, non-comparative interventional study including 25 eyes of 25% and a fakia associated with any posterior segment pathology or those with a postoperative follow-up less than 3 months. We are excluded from the study, and following was our standard ocular examination protocol. Coming to the important operative steps, after pupil centration marking was done, peripheral corneal marking was done at 4 and 10 o'clock position, followed by peritomy and then cautery at these two sites. And conjunctival flap was made, followed by making up sclerocorneal tunnel spanning 12 o'clock meridian. After that, after making side port entries, 23 gauge anterior root vitrectomy was performed, and a 3-piece IOL was preferred, and 4 standard 26 gauge needle bent to 60 degree about 1 mm from the hub we are used. The first bent 26 gauge needle was introduced into ciliary sulcus 1.5 mm behind the limbus at 4 o'clock position, and once the needle was visible within the papillary area, it was redirected and brought out to the corneal scleral tunnel. After that, leading haptic of IOL was threaded into the lumen of needle using MacPherson forceps, and the needle was withdrawn out of the sclerotomy along with the leading haptic, and leading haptic got exteriorized at 4 o'clock position. In similar way, trailing haptic was also exteriorized at 10 o'clock position. At next step, an intraoscular tunnel was made with the bent 26 gauge needle by starting 5 mm away from the exit point of haptics, going intrascleral and bringing needle near the exit site of haptic at 4 o'clock position. After that, leading haptic was threaded into the lumen of needle, and needle was withdrawn, and while withdrawing the needle, haptic gets tucked into the intraoscular tunnel. In similar way, trailing haptic was also tucked into the intraoscular tunnel at 10 o'clock position. So the mean age of patient was 57.8 years and mean follow-up period was of 3 months. While comparing mean pre-op and post-operative parameters, there was significant change in mean logmar BCV and mean spherical requirement, and none of the patient has any serious intraoperative and post-operative complications. While looking into cost-benefit analysis, in our modified technique, cost of the procedure is completely reduced, and it is very economical and affordable to the poor patients. So our study is comparable to the previous studies, and there was significant improvement in BCV was found with minimal complications. So our technique is different. First, it is sutureless. Second, there is no need of fibrin glue because the sclerotomies are very fine and small, and haptic manipulation is completely extraocular, so it is faster and less traumatic. While comparing with Yamane technique, in our technique, limbal pilot tunnel was made with the bent 26 gauge needle by starting 5 mm away from the exit point of haptics. So there is no need of vertical dissection. And here 26 gauge needle acts as a docking guide for intraoscular tucking of haptics. So in conclusion, our new technique is a simple, minimally invasive, cost effective, reduced dependency on special instruments, and better result outcome in the sense of serious complications, and a promising alternative to the conventional methods of SFIL. Thank you.
Thank you, Doctor. Could you just briefly tell us again how it is different from the Yamane technique?
Sir, in Yamane technique,
yeah.
They need vertical dissection because they made intraoscular tunnel by starting from the site of sclerotomy.
Yes.
But in our technique, we start making intraoscular tunnel by starting 5 mm away from the site of sclerotomy, parallel to the limbus.
Okay.
So in Yamane technique, there might be difficulty in tucking of the haptics into intraoscular tunnel because it was starting from the site of sclerotomy. In our technique, we are starting 5 mm away from the, we make intraoscular tunnel 5 mm away from the site of sclerotomy.
So don't you think, like, you know, if you are within the sclera with your 26 gauge needle for 5 millimeters and then you do a vertical entry, won't there be issues to maneuver the instrument to get your haptic into it?
No, sir, it was not too difficult.
No problem. Okay, thank you, doctor. Dr. Ralin Solomon presenting us about the accuracy of Barrett Universal and current third generation formulas for calculation of IOLPA.
Good morning, judges and one and all gathered. I'm here to present the results of the accuracy of Barrett Universal to Universal and current third generation formulas for calculation of IOL power. Modern day cataract surgery, as we all know, is more of a refractive procedure, with the spectacle independence being the foremost expectation of our patients. Choosing the right IOL formula for a patient is of paramount importance. And in this study, I'm here to present the outcomes of third generation formulas versus the Barrett formula. I have no financial interest. It was a comparative retrospective case record review conducted in the Eye Foundation Hospital, Coimbatore, Tamil Nadu, between February 2017 and May 2018. IOL Master 500 was used in all patients. Patients were included who had senile cataract and preoperative cylinder of less than 0.7 diopters. Single surgeon had done all the surgeries, and the same type of IOL was implanted in all of them. Patients who had previous refractive surgeries, intraoperative or postoperative complications, and patients with diabetes, hypertension, macular pathologies were excluded. The main outcomes analyzed were the mean absolute error and the percentage of eyes within 0.25 diopters, 0.25 to 5.5 diopters, and more than 0.5. They were grouped into two groups. The first group received Barrett Universal was used in all the axial lengths. In group two, based on the axial lengths, patients had IOL powers calculated. So this is the population statistics. There were 68 eyes in group one, and group two had 66 eyes. The mean age and male and female ratio was comparable. The mean absolute error, though, between both the groups were equally comparable. But when looking into the percentage prediction error, in group one, almost in the normal axial length, 98% of patients had less than 0.5 diopters of prediction error in group one, compared to 93 in group two. Whereas in short axial length, where the effective lens position calculation is difficult, is a challenge, almost 100% of the patients had less than 0.5 diopters of prediction error, compared to only 50% of patients in the other group. In the long axial length also, the Barrett Universal did well. IOL formulas have gone through a lot of changes, starting from theoretical to regression, and all the important goal of all these formulas is to calculate the effective lens position. The third generation formula uses axial length, corneal power, and the AC depth, of course, to calculate the effective lens position, whereas in Barrett Universal, it also takes into account the white-to-white and the lens factor. This is an optional variability that needs to be added on the system. Even in hospitals where they do not have an IOL master, a simple immersion can be done, and the values can be extrapolated and to got the best outcomes. So this is a single formula that can be used across all axial lengths, compared to the other formulas with exceptionally good outcomes. Thank you.
Thank you, Doctor.
How was the white-to-white measurement done?
So it was the machine itself, the IOL master.
The IOL master itself.
Yes. Yes.
No. So you've compared the third generation formulas to the Barrett Universal 2 across all axial lengths that
yes,
you
sir.
Said. So if you compared or if you grouped your patients into axial lengths, you said long eyes and short eyes. So how what do you call long? What do
yes.
you call short?
Axial length of more than 24 millimeter was considered as long,
okay.
And axial length of less than 22 millimeters was considered.
So between 22 and 24, you thought is you assumed as
normal axial.
Normal eyes.
Yes.
So anything less than 22, you consider as short.
Short eyes. Yes.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you so much.
Good morning, everyone. Today I would discuss about comparing the efficacy of difluprednate versus prednisolone eye drops on inflammation and intraocular pressure after cataract surgery. Is there is no financial interest for any product in this presentation. This was a single center based retrospective study. All cases were operated by a single surgeon by phaco emulsification. The number of cases were included were 1,000 consecutive patients in each group of prednisolone and difluprednate. Postoperatively, we have given prednisolone for total 5 weeks. In the first week, 6 times a day. Second and third week, 4 times. And last 2 weeks, 2 times. While the difluprednate has given only for the 3 weeks. First week, 4 times. Second week, 3 times. And last week is 2 times. All patients presented with the senile cataract were included. The factors which might affect the intraocular pressure were excluded. The exclusion criteria include patient with a pseudo exfoliation, traumatic cataract, past history of any other ocular surgery, uveitic cataract, and retinal pathology. Coming to the disc results, in the group analysis shows that there is a female predominance in both the groups. The study analysis showed that the number of patients in the difluprednate group was comparatively more compared to the prednisolone in 21 to 30 millifarad HG, almost four times higher than the prednisolone group. And patient with the difluprednate has more than one third of patient has more than IOP like 31 to 40 millimeter of HG. Coming to the postoperative inflammation, the reaction is more in both the group at the end of 2 months, but it is delayed post-op inflammation is more in difluprednate group at the end of 3 months. Concluding, the difluprednate is required to be shorter your duration only for 3 weeks compared to the prednisolone. But difluprednate is associated with more postoperative inflammation and higher fluctuation of intraocular pressure even up to 3 months postoperatively compared to the prednisolone acetate after cataract surgery. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, doctor. You mean to conclude that difluprednate shouldn't be used at all?
One advantage is there. We have to use for only shorter duration, only for 3 weeks. While we are prednisolone, we have to use 5 to 6 weeks postoperatively. And
it's quite ironical that the first study compared NSAID prednisolone and NSAID. And the last one compared difluprednate and prednisolone. Thank you so much.
Do we have a few speakers who are missing at the beginning? Dr. Manisha or Dr. Himali? Dr. O.P. Agarwal?
Yeah.
3 speakers who were not there at the beginning. They have not come, so we'll assume they are absent and close the session.
Thank you so much. Thanks for the patient hearing. Thank you.